Recording.
Hey everyone, welcome to this week's episode of the Crosschain Insider, a weekly roundup of all news traveling across chains, brought to you by LI.FI. I'm Mark, member of the BizDev team, and a member of the Starbucks times Polygon rewards waitlist. My GigaBrain co-host is Arjun, jack of all trades and master of everything here at LI.FI. What is up, Arjun?
You front ran me to that Starbucks X Polygon program. But it looks interesting though.
Yeah, I was laughing. Their name is Starbucks. And it's like, why aren't they calling every reward point in there something bucks? Like, it makes so much sense. But anyways, whatever.
I guess it's too obvious. That's why they're not doing it.
It's too obvious. And they probably don't want it. They probably don't want people to think it's money. So.
Yeah.
Anyways, we digress. We're already going down rabbit hole. So this is the Crosschain Insider. We've been off for about 2 weeks, 3 weeks, because it's been summer break, but we're back.
No, but it's for good reason. Like, it's not summer break, it's for good reason. And that will be shown soon.
Right. We've been writing like crazy. And so we just haven't had time to record a podcast, but now we're recording. So as usual, Arjun writes the Crosschain Insider, a weekly news recap of everything happening across chains. He publishes it as a newsletter on Substack. And we then go podcast about it later in the day, because some people don't like reading. And I don't like those some people, but that's okay. We still pod for them. Okay, so Arjun, bridge updates. What you got for us this week?
Yeah, so first up, there were a lot of network upgrades, even in the chains and even for like arbitrary messaging bridges. So first up is Axelar. They completed their Maeve upgrade. So it's their mainnet upgrade, codenamed Maeve. So they've like introduced a lot of new features, but the one that stands out the most is the implementation of quadratic voting. So this really bolsters the security and decentralization of Axelar's validator set. So a lot of externally verified bridges, they have validators, and they face a lot of criticism for like not having decentralized validator sets. So quadratic voting is like one step in that direction to, you know, kind of suppress all of those concerns and move towards in a decentralized direction. So it's a great step, and it's one of its kind. No one else has done it till now.
Yeah. And as usual, Arjun has the big brain take on this quadratic voting. Actually, very interesting. If you're want to go deeper into this topic, Vitalik has a fantastic blog post on quadratic voting, which maybe we'll throw in the links to this episode. But I just wanted to add, Maeve right now, the name's kind of ruined for me because I've been watching The Boys on Amazon Prime, and like Maeve is just like. Like it's just not as cool of a character. Like Westworld, fantastic. The Boys, meh. Okay. Anyways, that's my take.
Totally on topic, but let's move on to LayerZero. So they introduced their summer of 2022 update. So this was like so many new features that you can't even see if in a single Twitter thread that what all they've introduced. So I've basically mentioned four bullet points. So the entire bridging section could have been just LayerZero. But first is their pre-crime feature, which they introduced in a blog post in like May. This is now live. So any developer can now use this feature. This feature has been used by Stargate since launch. So this feature can basically allow developers to define custom security guarantees. And this is done by setting their own invariants for all messaging. So Stargate already uses this, but now it's available for everyone to use. The second one is LayerZero Scan. So this is an omni-chain blockchain explorer for all LayerZero messages. So like, how does one transaction goes from one chain to another chain through LayerZero's infrastructure? This basically shows that. Something similar to this was Axelar Scan. So that has been live for a long time. So people who are aware of that can basically relate. The third one is ultralight node library. So this library is basically all the support, like the tech support that is required for all these new features and all the upcoming new chains that LayerZero will support. This library has it all. And the fourth one is new chain. So Layer Zero has added support for Moonbeam, Harmony, which like is not live right now, Swimmer, and DFK. And they've also added support for 8 other pre-launch chains testnets. So these chains, like whenever their mainnet goes live, Layer Zero will add support for their mainnet. And these chains are mainly all the non-EVMs, such as Aptos, Sui, and Solana. So a lot of updates from Layer Zero in just like one Twitter thread.
I can't wait to see if pre-crime catches on, and if it does catch on, if it catches anything. I think pre-crime is the highlight of this blog post.
But that's the feature that has been like live since May. So it's like
it's been live, but it's been constrained.
Yeah, it's been public knowledge. It's not been live, but it's been public knowledge.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I think Layer Zero has like a habit of kind of doing so much in the background, and then just in one Twitter thread, they'll just tell you, oh, we've done so much more than you.
Hey, speaking of something built on top of Layer Zero.
Yeah, so next up is Stargate, and LI.FI has added support for Stargate. So this is now the 11th bridge that we support, but the 10th bridge that is currently live in production on LI.FI. So yeah, if you like Stargate, if you like LI.FI, just go try it out now on transfer2.xyz.
Look at you. That was such a BD explanation. It's our 11th bridge, but we only have 10 in production. That's awesome. Love it.
Yeah, see, because I wrote the Twitter announcement, so I know. Up next, we have a PSA from Ronin. So they've recovered 30 million from the bridge hack that happened 4 months ago. So this is basically the US government and Chain Analysis, which is like a security firm. They've worked together and they've recovered nearly 30 million in stolen funds. And the team says that the 30 million accounts for 12% of the stolen funds, as the current total value of the stolen funds is 250 million. So the original value was 600 million, but the current value of those funds is 250 million. So 30 million is 12%. I mean, that's correct maths, but I don't know if it works like that.
Chainalysis is single-handedly trying to disprove all the people out there saying the only people who use blockchain are criminals. Chainalysis is like, no, actually, we're just going to catch every single criminal that ever used a blockchain.
Actually, everyone is a criminal, but on like different levels. And we'll show you how.
Chainalysis, they'll find you.
Okay. Yeah. So up next, like staying on the theme of funds recovery, Nomad, they've recovered 37 million of the 186 million that they lost in the bridge hack in August, like 2nd of August. So I think they released a blog post titled Road to Recovery Roadmap. And when they released it, they were on phase one, which is the recovery phase. And now they say that they're in the phase two of the roadmap, which is basically the design mechanism for the fair distribution of recovered funds. They've completed that. The smart contract audits have kicked off. And what all this means is that phase three, which is the restart of the Nomad Bridge, is likely going to start in early October, which is great news.
Yep. And if you look at their Twitter thread here, law enforcement is making, where did they say it? Anyways, law enforcement is making headway. That was the big takeaway from that Twitter thread. I can't find the exact quote right now.
Last, we have Rainbow Bridge. So they've paused Rainbow Bridge for the merge. You'll see, like on Twitter, you'll see a lot of announcements. Every project has a different take on this. But I think in general, all bridges are kind of pausing operations for the time being, like the merge timeline. And then they'll test everything if it's okay, and then they'll restart. So Rainbow Bridge, basically, they've paused all the operations as of 1 p.m. CET on September 11th. And the team basically says that during the merge, there will be several technical risks, and this step has been taken to mitigate them. So once the merge is completed, they will check everything and resume the bridge.
Yep. And they had a fantastic blog post on the Ethereum merge and what to expect on Aurora. The TLDR of this is, it kind of sounds like the Aurora team isn't 100% sure what's going to happen, how many forks there are going to be, and how long it's going to take post-merge to go live again. So if you're bridging, they recommended, I mean, they shut down their bridge already, but they recommended finalizing everything ASAP and kind of just taking a break while the merge was going on, yeah, which
like,
I think
it's like crypto summer, 1 week off for everyone because Ethereum is under construction.
Right. Exactly. But not off. It's off for builders, but like, I'm sure there's some retail trades that will be very fun here with all the forks going on. I cannot wait to see. Okay. We're getting ahead of ourselves. All right. So that is it for bridge updates. Next is just what's going on in the multi-chain world, which I will lead here. And the biggest news, as Aurora just hinted at, well, not Aurora, the Rainbow Bridge, but the Bellatrix update for Ethereum, it is live now. The merge is expected to happen this week. We'll talk about that more in the What's Poppin' section. I cannot believe this is actually coming to fruition. I'm a little nervous, but I'm also excited. Next update is Cardano's Vassal upgrade now has a date. I guess they didn't want to let the merge have a full week of rest because Cardano set September 22nd as the date for the Vassal upgrade.
I'm just waiting for all the bridge updates that they've paused operations because of the Cardano upgrade.
I'm going to be totally honest. I am not a Cardano expert, but the Vassal has been something they've been looking forward to for a long time in that ecosystem. So that is good for them. I'm glad that they are moving on. Next, this is probably the most interesting headline I saw this week, but
Binance... I almost didn't put it in because like it was not on topic, but it was not off topic as well.
Yeah, so we need a trading expert to come onto the show for this. Maybe we'll bring on Fragile Shark or something like that from our BD team at a later date. But Binance introduced BUSD auto conversion starting on September 29th. This will see users' existing balances in new deposits of USDC, USDP, and TUSD automatically converted to BUSD at a one-to-one ratio. This will help Binance with liquidity. So if you can see, look at all of these pairs that they're getting rid of. And so all of these are now going to be trading directly against BUSD, which I'm sure is great for Binance, seeing as they are very active in the creation of BUSD. However, I don't know what the main issue is with other stablecoins. Like, I'd love to see read a thread from someone from a USDC perspective on if this even matters, because you can still withdraw USDC, TUSD, and USDP from Binance. So
I think maybe they just didn't have enough demand for it because they've not stopped USDT. That's still live.
Yeah. Well, it's just a liquidity thing. It's just like, hey, let's get rid of all these pairs, trade them against BUSD, and people want to withdraw one-to-one. Like, okay, they can deposit USDC and then we can mint BUSD against that, and easy enough. Okay, next up, the liquid staking wars on Cosmos. They're coming soon. So the Lido community proposed a framework for deploying Lido as a custom implementation designed to serve the liquid staking needs of the entire IBC ecosystem. Now, what the heck does that mean? Pretty much, Lido wants to launch on Neutron, which is a Cosmos chain. And then from there, once liquid staking is live on one IBC interchain account, Cosmwasm chain, you have to have four or five different things that you have to have on Cosmos to be able to make this work. But anyways, they're going to deploy on Neutron. And then from there, liquid assets will be able to be transferred across the Cosmos ecosystem. And this should be a huge boost for Cosmos DeFi. Because right now, because of how Cosmos chains work, a lot of the supply is liquid and people are just staking and staking and staking because that's where all of the rewards are. But really, there's not really a huge stablecoin and there's not much actual DeFi activity going on. Lido going to Cosmos would be absolutely massive. Do you have anything else to add there?
No, I want you to move on to the next one because it's like the same week there are two similar announcements.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. This is the proposal for Lido going interchain. Very good proposal. Should definitely read it.
It's actually by a core contributor of Lido. So it's like this guy works for both the teams. Yep.
And then it looks like I didn't open up the link for the next headline, but I'll read it out. Oh, here. Now, here's what we're going to do. Boom. We're going to just scroll. Look at this. Nice. But now people can see what's next, too. Anyways, Stride, a blockchain built using the Cosmos SDK, is now offering multi-chain liquid staking services for the Cosmos ecosystem. So you've all used staked ETH or STETH. Now Statum is going to exist, staked app, thanks to Stride. And you're excited about Stride. Why are you excited about Stride?
I'm not excited about Stride in particular, but it's like we're seeing a lot of announcements and then each protocol is like trying to front run the other one. So with LayerZero and Axelar, it was like mainnet upgrades and both of them kind of did it in the same week. This is something that we saw with Polygon and the ZK Vaults. And then again, suddenly liquid staking, two announcements in the same week. So it's becoming a trend. No one wants to let the other guys have attention for a long time.
Yeah. Speaking of some sort of war, right? We just saw the liquid staking wars on Cosmos. The ZK war, where teams announce a ZK-based chain months in advance of it actually coming out. BNB is now in the game. So BNB... is introducing zkBNB, an industry-leading zero-knowledge proof-based scaling solution. It went live to testnet on September 2nd, and I think it will be coming soon. I don't know if there's an exact release date for it. So
they've just said we'll release mainnet by the end of this year.
Yep, and I think there's a couple other ZKs coming out at that time.
Exactly.
It's a race to be first. I'm sure we'll talk about it at that time. Lastly, Algorand announced a major upgrade to its protocol, which is now live on mainnet. The upgrade features state proofs, which enable trustless cross-chain communication. I need to do a deep dive to see if I believe if it's truly trustless. That's a big word for us here at LI.FI. But with the upgrade, you get a 5x increase in performance from 1,200 to 6,000 transactions per second, which that is a mighty big upgrade.
5x.
I said 5x, right?
Okay.
I think I said 5x. This is a pretty big deal. Algorand's still out here shipping. I find it funny that we are actually getting like press releases from crypto companies this week. Like we had one for Axelar and we're going to have one for Algorand. I think maybe do we need to do a press release here at LI.FI? Like, no,
I think it's just some of the projects is that style. I've seen a lot of press release from Algorand, so I'm not surprised.
Okay. Yeah, I was just like, okay, interesting. All right, next up is What's Poppin', where Arjun scrolls Twitter for about an hour and thinks, what did I just read?
Usually, like, whatever is in this section, I don't need to scroll Twitter for it because it's, like, right in your face. Yeah. So... this is like the merge week, and of course we can't talk about anything else other than the merge. So usually, like, everything in the news about crypto is like we don't make it to the mainstream news unless it's like a hack or something, some cryptocurrency exploding to zero. But this time even the real world, the Web2 world, is also paying attention. So if you Google the merge right now, you'll see the countdown to the merge. And this section in our newsletter is basically some great threads that you can check out to prepare yourself for the merge, which is going to go live this week.
Dude, I don't know if I'm going to be able to sleep on the merge night. It's just going to be, I'm actually going to, this is the lamest thing I'm going to say on this podcast ever. I'm going to go to a merge party.
It's tough to find those people, but okay.
There's a meetup wherever I live. Can't dox myself, right? where I'm going to a merge party. They're gonna have the green tea and wine thing that
of course
Alex tweeted out, they're gonna have that there, which sounds really gross, but should be fun.
There's a merch party in India as well. It's in Bangalore, but I can't go.
Dang. Maybe you can like zoom in to my merch party.
That's lame.
That's lame. Okay.
This meme is great, by the
way. It's so good. That's me. Okay. So the last section of the podcast is interesting reads. Arjun, what you got?
So the first one is basically a Synapse protocol risk analysis. So as you know, L2B will basically publish a full bridge risk framework soon. And this is kind of an insight into what they're looking at in terms of like profiling each bridge by their risk profile. So he's given a breakdown of how they go about looking at each contract and how people can do it themselves as well when they're bridging. But of course, we're lazy and we don't look at smart contracts when bridging, right?
Look, we have too many bridges to aggregate. Mm-hmm. We do look at all that stuff. But no.
In general, the regular audience doesn't look at this, but it's like, it's great insight into how someone like Bartek looks at a bridge and the risks involved.
For sure.
Yeah. So the next one is by the Coinbase threat intelligence team. So they've done an incident analysis and security recommendation based on the CBridge, I think, front-end attack. So CBridge front-end was hijacked and there was a phishing attack on the protocol. So this blog is basically, they do an incident analysis and they give like security recommendations for all crypto projects. So I think it's a good read for anyone involved in crypto and even users, because we are the victims of these attacks. Yeah, definitely check it out.
Shout out to Coinbase for publishing informational blogs like this. More and more people should read these, because it's just, I mean, they put some work into it.
Is an understatement.
Okay, they put a lot of work into this. So you should definitely go read it.
Yeah, and the third one is notes on Synapse and GMX's Twitter Spaces. So, you should ideally check out the Twitter Spaces, but the link is not available right now because I think they'll publish it later on. So these notes are kind of a good summary of what happened. They talk about like how Synapse can be a good building ground for applications once the Synapse chain is like.
Beautiful. And on my side, it's kind of a short week for recommended reads. But since we've been off on the Crosschain Insider for the last couple of weeks, I thought I'd just shield my own bag, and we came out with a bridging survival guide. And so like, if you ever wanted to be like, hey, I want to read 10 articles to totally understand the bridge space, where do I find those 10 articles? Well, this little news resource here, which is called LI.FI's Declassified Bridge Survival Guide. Just check it out. It has all these links. And then a quick write-up on some of our favorite bridge tools. That's about it. You have anything else, Arjun?
No, that's about it. Waiting for the merge now.
All we're doing is waiting for the merge.
Of course.
And with that, that's the latest episode of the Crosschain Insider. For more info, please be sure to subscribe to the Crosschain Insider, the newsletter that Arjun writes that we just went over. You can also check out LI.FI, LI.FI. We're building the ultimate cross-chain money Lego. You can find LI.FI on Twitter at LI.FI Protocol, at LI.FI Protocol. Or you can just come join us on Discord. We're a good hang. And that is it for the week.